we are live.
A very good evening to all the members of the Bombay Orthopedic Society and all of you all who have been invited here and are watching this webinar. We all agree that these are difficult times. Difficult times call drastic measures, but it circumstances and evolve. Medicine in general, but it is also this. Today, we speak on a non-orthopedic topic, which is very relevant to the present times. And this topic
is it recording?
Essentially, is
you don't want to record.
No, you are not recording. Yes.
Swapnil, your voice is breaking. Swapnil, we can't hear you. Your voice is breaking. Swapnil, I think you have a problem with your internet. Hello, Swapnil, can you hear me? Swapnil, we can't hear you. I think there is a problem with your connection.
There was something even I couldn't also hear, but now I can hear.
So I think there is a problem with Swapnil's connection. Dr. Sangeet,
yeah,
can you take over? Maybe he has some problem with his connection.
Yeah. Greetings to all. I am Dr. Sangeet Gawale, President, Bombay Orthopedic Society. I welcome you all for this evening webinar. And as you are all facing the same problem, we are not working to our full capacity. And so our earnings have come down significantly. We have saved a lot in past and we invest in either FDs or we do trading. Some of us invest in mutual funds, some in gold, some in properties. And we don't have any clarity because we are not professionals in that respect. So to understand and to make money from what we have saved, we are starting the first webinar on this topic. We'll have similar webinars every month, but that will be on different topics. So we have our guest, Dr. Manoj Agrawal, who's a renowned ophthalmologist. He practices around Kandivali. He's attached to various hospitals. And my association is 25 years back in JJ Hospital, where we were working together. I welcome you, Manoj, and we can start now with your talk. The question and answers, we'll take it at the end. In the chat box, either you can raise your hand or type your questions. So we will put it to Manoj, who can answer subsequently after his talk. I welcome you, Manoj, once again.
Thank you, Sangeet. I'm honored, and I would like to thank the Bombay Orthopedic Society for giving me this opportunity to share my views and experiences with you all, and hopefully make you better investors and stress-free life later on. Is my screen and my audio visible and audible to you all?
Yes, Sangeet, it is audible.
Yeah. So should I continue now?
Yes, please continue.
Okay. I am an ophthalmologist and I am a doctor like you all. I have got no financial qualification. Before I go ahead, I would like to thank a few people. Most important is Mr. Deendra Kumar. He's the CEO of the Value Research Online.com, and I've been following him regularly since many, many years now. And most of my talk is going to be what I have learned from his webinars and from his online portal and his magazines. Dr. Rohit Modi is an ophthalmologist from Bombay, and he's the one who started me, encouraged me to start giving talks and lectures like this. And obviously, Dr. Sangeet Gawale, who, as he mentioned, I know him since many, many decades. He's the one who's invited me and honored me by giving a part of this webinar. And lastly, but not the least, all of you all webinar engineers who've been joining to listen to me. One appeal to you all is that as far as possible, for all our prescriptions, please use Indian make. And I'm not a qualified financial expert, so whatever I'm going to talk to you is from my understanding and my experience, whatever I've read, and I've made mistakes in the past, fallen down, lost money, learned from my mistakes, and what I'm telling you is from my experience, which hopefully you can benefit and do better in the long run. After my talk, I hope you'll be able to save and invest in a much better way. Okay. Now, if you look at historically, if you look at the last 30, 40, 50 years, and if you compare the returns of various investments, then this is just one snapshot. But if you've invested 10,000 rupees about 42 years ago, then the current value of that would be, depending on where everybody would be about 6 lakhs, gold would be about 4.5 lakhs, but the Sensex would be about 50 lakh rupees. Okay, now Sensex is a broad spectrum for the equity investments. I'll talk to you in detail later on. Okay. Now, why do we invest money? Okay, we invest money to create wealth. Now, why do you want wealth? We want to make wealth so that we use it for our emergency purposes, for our day-to-day investments, for our expenses, for running our home, our clinics, for retirement, for our emergency purposes, for our health purposes, and maybe for retirement. When we retire, we want to have that enough savings so that we can lead a relaxed life without stress or without worrying later on. What is the secret of successful investment? Okay, so the question is, what is the secret of to becoming a successful investor, and what is the secret to finding out what the secret is? The answer is, there is no such secret. Okay, all the rules, the avenues, the options, the rules and the temperament or whatever is needed is all available free. The only thing is, most of us don't know where to access it. And even if we've accessed it, we don't understand much about it. And that is what the problem is. So I'll try to solve these secrets for you. Okay. Now, one thing to mention, how do we buy things? For example, if you want to buy a pair of shoes or clothes or whatever, we have a general idea of the type of shoe, whether it's for sports, for formal use, for home use, etc. We have the size in mind, we have the design we have in mind, and we go and buy it. Unfortunately, financial products, when we buy, we have no idea about what to go about it, what is suitable to us, what to buy, how to buy, where to buy. And therefore, people who have much inferior knowledge than us take us for a ride and they laugh behind us back. Okay. And when we make a bad choice, we may realize that we made a bad choice much later in life. By then, it's too late. Okay. But I tell people that whatever mistakes you've made, forget about it. When you realize you made a mistake, come out of it and think about the future. You know, jab jago tab savera, don't cry on spoiled milk. It is gone. Forget about it. And now don't make a mistake and continue and learn from these mistakes. Okay. One thing you should understand, very important, is that you should have distress as your default option in your mind. What do you mean by that? Okay. Now, whenever you buy any financial product, whether it's mutual fund, insurance, FDs, or people, whatever it is, okay, it is your money. So it is, you invest, you give your money to somebody, that person takes your money, does something with it, takes out his commission for his income, for his salary, for his profits, and makes your money grow and gives it back to you. So it is your money which is going round and round. So the only way you can make more money is that if he gets less money, and he can make more money by giving you less money. So remember, it is your money. That's finance is the only product, only avenue where it's your money going around. Unlike, say, you buy a car, you give money to somebody, you get a car. But in finance, it is your money going there round and round. So think of this carefully. So why is somebody approaching you and giving you or telling you about this product? That product is because he's thinking about his products and his commission. So remember this. So never fall for this gimmicks. Trust nobody. Okay. Now, what is the right approach to investing? Okay. See, when you're investing, you've got various options available. You've got gold, bank deposits, stocks, mutual funds, property, etc., etc. Okay. But you should be, you should decide what is suitable to you, and we'll come to that next. Okay. So the first step is you should know your expenses, your liabilities, your assets, and your savings. And you should make a list of all of these currently what you have. Okay. You may need a health cover. I put a question mark because all of us don't need the health cover. Also, the question mark on term life insurance. I have a question mark because all of us may not need it. Okay. And you should have a 6 months contingency fund available to you so that, like, for example, Corona times, income is less. But if you had a contingency fund, then you would have been tied over it. Okay. You should ask yourself, what are the financial goals? You are investing for how long? Is it for after 10 years, for 20 years, 30 years? What kind of investments you should make? Where you should invest? How you should invest? And do you understand where you are investing? I'll be talking briefly about these things. Okay. For example, this is a slide of a teacher who was appointed for a kindergarten school in somewhere in Europe. He spent about 35 lakh rupees on doing this, and the students got so scared of him that he had to be thrown out. Okay. So he was a wrong man for the job. Similarly, what is right for you may not be right for somebody else. What is right for me may not be right for you. So you should choose what is right for you. Okay. Now, certain invite concept. Differentiate between needs and wants. What is need and what is want? Need is something which is necessary. Food, clothing, shelter, your insurance, your education of children, your commutation, etc. Want is luxury, which you can necessarily or easily avoid. Okay. The third richest man in the world, Warren Buffett, he's worth about $120 billion, still lives in the house which he bought about 63 years ago. He's not changed his residence. Okay. Savings is something which you keep for your expenses. Investment is what you is so that you can grow your investment and for your various purposes. A thumb rule is that you should invest as much as possible or save as much as possible. Generally, in your 20s, save 20%, in 30s, 30%, in 40s, 40%, in 50s and beyond, maybe at least half your income you should be able to save. Okay. What is a portfolio? A portfolio is a collection of all your investments, which means your property, your gold, your mutual fund, your stocks, etc., etc. Okay. And your portfolio should have a balance of various type of investments. Okay. Now, what are returns, risk, liquidity, and volatility? Returns means when you invest something, how much would you get out of it is your returns. Risk is what is the probability of you getting your returns, or what is the probability of your investment losing it. Okay. Liquidity means how easy you can access your money. And volatility is that how much your investment or your returns would fluctuate. Okay. What are shares, equity, stocks, and scrips? Okay. Now, when you have a company, shares, stocks, equity, etc., is the company or the management gives you partial ownership of the company in the form of shares. So when you buy shares on your own, you are part owner of the company. Your ownership could be maybe a fraction of, or it could be 1 in million or 1 in crore or whatever, but you are part owner of it. So you take part in the company's growth, fortunes, etc. So the company does well, your share value goes up. If the company doesn't do well, it crashes. Okay. And these are listed on the stock exchange and they're very volatile. Debts, bond, guild, FDs, or PPF, etc. are a loan given to the bank, company, or the government, and they give you a fixed return on it. Okay. So they are generally fixed and they're generally not volatile. Okay. But the returns are going to be less. And for your personal analysis, property, jewelry, etc. has to be taken as part of your debt portfolio. All returns or all investments carry risk. Okay. Equity investments are higher risk. Debt investments are relatively lesser risk. And in general, higher the risk, higher the return in general. Okay. You should have realistic expectations. Start small, build on it. Don't fear in risk. And if it looks too good to be true, then probably there is no free lunch. And you should review your portfolio regularly, at least every three, four months. And do not invest in something which you don't understand. I don't understand derivatives, commodities, direct stocks. So I don't do those things. And do not fall in love with mutual funds. I don't. If a fund performs poorly or the returns go down, performance goes down, I switch out of it. So don't get emotionally attached to your investments. Don't rush to book profits. Stay away from gold and jewelry. and do not miss insurance and investment. Be digitally partly savvy so you can track your investment and do investments online. Don't take any home loan except a home loan. Save as much as possible. And if you take insurance, it should be only term insurance. Other insurance are not worth it. And never fall talk to the deep talk of your advisor, broker, friend, banker, etc. As I said in your talk initially, okay, have distrust as your default notion. Okay. And it is actually okay to be okay. Don't think that your scheme or investment should be doing the top of the line. Doesn't mean even if you have done average returns, believe me, over a period of years and years, it will become phenomenally high. Don't chase the best. The best may be best today, but a few years down the line, it may become poor. So don't chase best. Don't time the market. It's important is the amount of time in the market is more important than timing the market. And should you forget about it? No. And to invest the revenue of its performance. Okay. Now I'll talk of certain important concepts which you all should understand. There are a lot of them. I'll just talk briefly about some of them which are in maroon color for your understanding. Now, what is inflation? Inflation is a silent villain that loves to devour up money. Okay, we know that inflation reduces our money power. What you could buy for 100 rupees today, after a year, you may have to spend 110, 120 rupees. This is inflation. So with inflation, the value of the money goes down. Okay, and your real rate of return should be the rate of return minus inflation and taxes. So it cuts down on your return. This is very important. Okay. Like, for example, if you could buy a trolley for a goods of 1998, today you could buy maybe hardly anything. So this is the value of rupee going down. Like, for example, if it is 1 lakh rupee today, then 10 years today, it will be about half. This is at 6% region, which is the current rate of inflation today. Okay. It is not so high that Zimbabwe, some years back, had printed currency of $100 trillion. This was the value of the currency some years back. Okay. If we use the rule of 70, so current inflation would divide by 70 gives you the amount of value to half. Suppose the inflation rate today is 6, 70 by 6 is approximately 12. So your value of money will become half in 12 years. This is the rough rule you can use. Okay. Now, what is cost inflation index or CII? This is a government-induced value given every year. And this is so that your purchase cost goes up depending on the inflation. So your profit or your long-term capital gains reduces, so your tax goes down. So government is giving you benefit of inflation. This is called as the indexation or the cost inflation index. And this is declared by the government every year. Okay. The base rate is 2001, which is 100, and currently it is about 301. So it has gone up by 3 times in the last 20 years. Okay. This compound interest, your money earns interest, okay, and that interest subsequently also becomes part of the principal and that earns interest. So interest on interest is compound interest, and over a period of years it is phenomenal. So compound interest makes your money grow as a geometric mean, which is if you see this table here, okay, you can see the kick which you've got after a few years is the compound interest, which has given you a huge amount of growth. Okay. As an example, if you invest 100 rupees per day, which is a very small amount, for 100 rupees per day for 30 years, 12% return, which is not a huge amount if you invest in mutual funds, after 30 years, you would have a crore of rupees. Okay, you would have invested actually only 11 lakh rupees, but you would get a crore of rupees in 30 years. So if you're 25 years today, invest 100 rupees per day, which is not a big amount, which is about 36,000 rupees a year. Okay, so you're 25 today, you invest that much at the age of 55, you have at least a crore of rupees, which is very easily attainable. This is the benefit of compounding. Okay, like you take an example here, you've got two people, both invest 50,000 rupees per month for at age of 12 years, 12% not a big amount. One starts at the age of 26 years, one starts at the age of 31 years. The difference of only 5 years at the age of 55. Okay, one would have one would have about 4.5 crore rupees, and the other would have only 2.5 crore rupees. A difference of 5 years only because of loss of compounding makes such a big difference. Okay. Alfred Einstein said that compound interest is the eighth wonder of the world. Okay. What's the rule of 72, 114, and 144? Again, this is something very simple. So rule of 72 is that if you divide the rate of interest by 72, it tells you the amount, the duration of years, in how much your returns will double. For example, if you put in 100 rupees and you're getting 6% per year, so 72 divided by 6 becomes 12. So your money will double in about 12 years. If you're getting an investment returns of 9%, then 72 by 9 becomes 8. So your returns will enter investment double in 8 years. That's the roughly way to do it. Okay. And 114 is the same similarity, gives you about 3 times, and 144 tells you in about 4 times. Okay. So simple as that. Okay. Now, what is asset balancing and asset allocation and asset rebalancing? So different asset classes perform differently. Now, we will have investment in property, gold, fixed deposits, equity, mutual funds, etc., etc. So if you calculate all of them and you decide the ratio of all of them, so that is your asset allocation. Okay, so we invested maybe 10% property, 40%, whatever. This is your asset allocation. Now, each of these will give you returns differently. Some may perform well in 1 year, somebody in different year. So your asset allocation ratio keeps on changing. It is a dynamic thing, which is, let's say your mutual fund, let's say equity is 10% this year. If it does well, maybe next year the ratio may become 15%. So your asset allocation keeps on changing. And if you want to maintain the asset allocation, then you will need to rebalance this. So if you want to maintain the same ratio, then you would have to probably liquidate 5% of the equities and put in somewhere else. So this is asset rebalancing. This is dynamic. You should be doing it at least once in 2 years, depending on your comfort level. Okay. So this is asset allocation and rebalancing. This is already done with you. Okay. Now what is market capitalizing? You hear people, Sensex and Nifty, and all your 30, 40 news channels keep on talking about it. And people say, "Aaj Nifty itna ho gaya, Sensex itna ho gaya hai." Then I put in large cap, put in mid cap, or put in small cap. So what are these terminologies? I'll just tell you briefly what it is. Okay. Today, the Indian market capitalization is about $3 trillion. And we are about the seventh largest in the world. Okay. Which is a very good thing. Largest is the US, but we are about at seventh place in the world today. Okay. Now, what is Sensex or Nifty? India, we've got two main stock exchanges. One is the Bombay Stock Exchange. The second is the National Stock Exchange. BSE. So Sensex is, so Bombay Stock Exchange in 1779 came up with a list of 30 shares, okay, a group of 30 shares, which were at that time the best and the most performing and the large ones. And they called it the Sensex. Similarly, the National Stock Exchange came up with its own terms or shares of 50. They called it Nifty 50. So we have Sensex, which is a group of 30 shares, Nifty of 50 shares. Okay, so these are the Sensex and Nifty. So they are supposed to represent the market, the share market. In India, India has the largest number of companies listed in the world, which is almost about 6,000 to 7,000 companies. So Nifty, Sensex is 30 shares, Nifty is 50 shares. Okay. And the base was taken in 1978-79, which was 100. Today is about 51,000. So the Bombay Stock Exchange, the Sensex, has grown up almost 500 times. Anything in the last 42, 43 years. Okay. So that's a huge growth. Okay. And if you see this, the names have changed. If you see from 2001 to the last 20 years, only 9 companies are still persisting. Just 21 companies are no longer the part of the index. Now, if you arrange all these companies, so, and what is market cap of company? The total share market value. So the number of shares multiplied by the number of shares gives you the market cap. For example, if the Reliance is about 2000 odd rate today, and if you multiply the number of shares, gives you the market cap of a company. Okay, the largest company here today is Reliance, which is about 12 lakh crores. Second is TCS, third is HDFC Bank. Okay, so that's what it is. Now, if you arrange these companies in the descending order, then the top 100 companies are called as large cap, which are approximately more than 525,000 crore. The next 150 companies are the mid-cap companies. Generally, market cap is about 25,000 to 5,000. And the remaining rest, so 151 to about 6,000 are the small-cap companies. These are generally market cap less than 5,000 crores. Okay. So this is, when you talk of companies, so I hope you understand what is market cap, what is Sensex, what is Nifty, what is large cap, mid-cap, and small-cap. Okay. Now we come to in this. Okay. Okay. Now, as I said, there are various different types of investments. Okay. Now, how do you go about investing? So first, you should decide where you would like to go, how much you should have in equity, debt, real estate, gold. Okay, I'll give a different briefly a little bit later on. Okay, so once you decide that I want to buy, let's say, and so this is the first thing you'll do is how much in equity, fixed income, real estate. Then suppose you decide that I want to have an X amount in equity. So that's the second step is, so if you want in equity, then in equity, would you like to go through mutual fund or would you like to go on your own and invest directly in shares? Okay, that's the second thing. Okay, so suppose you decide that I want to have an Y amount in mutual funds. So the third thing would be, now would be the final thing is, okay, so why mutual funds? So how much in which type of mutual fund, and there you decide which particular mutual fund. Okay, so you will go to three stages. How much of each type of investment, then in that type, which mode you will take, and then it's selectively, finally you come to the which specific investment. Maybe we could have some questions if people want before we go to the second talk on mutual funds. Sangeet, if people have some questions to ask, so far I've given a brief overview of investment psychology and how the thought process should be done.
Yeah, if people, Dr. Manoj, if you can hear me, I have a question.
Sorry?
You wanted question and answers, right?
If people have questions to ask now, yes. Go to mutual funds.
Yeah, yeah. So just one question. You said about Sensex and Nifty. So what are the essential shares? Are they the topmost shares of the market or are they the top most growing shares of the market which decide Sensex and Nifty?
Can you repeat the question?
So are they the topmost shares, the most expensive shares in the market or the most growing shares?
They means what?
The Sensex and Nifty, you said, are 30 and 50 shares.
Sensex and Nifty, Bombay Stock Exchange and National Stock Exchange has their own administrative body and they decide which shares to take. They have their own criteria. It is on the market capitalization. They also see that every company, they should be representative of various sectors. We've got finance, we've got commodities, FMCGs, IT, automobiles, ancillaries, consumer goods, textiles, etc. So they would take different sectors should be represented. And in those sectors, among the best ones, they take. Okay, so it depends. It is a representative of the overall market. But one caveat here is that if you take the Sensex, then the top four of them are almost 40% of the Sensex. So it is a little skewed. That is the fine tuning, which is little difficult to understand. So since you asked me a question, this is decided by the administrative body and this is done twice a year. Okay. So it doesn't make a difference to us. Okay. Now, if you invest in an index fund, I'll come to that later on, then you have nothing to do about it. The investment body will ultimately do the buying and selling to maintain the index or whatever it is. Okay. So this is what an index is. The administrator decide we have anything to do with it. And generally, it is supposed to represent the different components of the market. I hope I'm clear in that.
Right. Thank you, sir.
But most of them would be large cap companies.
Perfect.
Yeah. So should I continue the mutual funds?
Yeah, please go ahead, sir.
Okay. Sir, there is a question in the chat box. Maybe Swapnil sir can read it out.
I can't. You have to read it out.
Can you go ahead and do that?
The question is that what are the good index listed funds in the market now?
In good indirect listed funds?
Index linked funds in the market now.
It will come. It will come in my talk as in mutual fund. When I'm going, it will come into the talk. So just tell them to hold on.
Right.
So should I continue the mutual funds now?
Yes, you can continue.
Fine. Okay. So now what are mutual funds? Okay, now the word mutual means to share. Okay, so that's an English noun meaning to share. So what is mutual fund is that a group of people, it could be so group of people come together and we invest the money together, we give our money to somebody, okay, to somebody So a group of investors come together mutually. The money is pooled by a particular asset management company, which is given to a fund manager depending on the mandate. Okay. And the fund manager is a professional, he's got a professional investment research team, and they invest their money in the securities depending on the mandate and where we put our money. And because they're professional and their money, depending on the investment, it grows. Okay, that is what the returns are. And whenever we want the money, we tell them to give us back to us, and that is how the money is given back to us. So this is how mutual fund structure works. Okay, there is an asset management company, which is the head of the company, they appoint trustees, the transfer agents, the custodians, etc. And they launch different type of schemes. Okay, they professionally running each type of scheme. Okay, and they invest our money, plus they have the back office which manages the purchase, sale, customer relations, etc., etc. And all this is very tightly and strictly related by SEBI. Remember one thing: SEBI, Securities and Exchange Board of India, which is extremely investor friendly. It is in our favor. So most of the rules, regulations are in our favor, and SEBI is very good. It looks after investor interests. Okay. Now, the mutual fund is a vehicle for a definite asset class. Through people think, you know, that mutual fund means shares. No. Through mutual funds, you can invest in equity, debt, bond, gold, real estate, commodities, fixed income, etc. So you need not invest in FDs or deposits, etc. on your own. Mutual funds can do all this for you. Okay, so you know, people mistake mutual funds as only an X entity. No, depending on what you want, you can do all this through the mutual funds at very low cost with professional management expertise. Okay, so mutual fund is like a portfolio on its own. It is not a specific entity. It is when you do, suppose you put in equity, they will buy n number of equity. You put in debt, they will have a big portfolio of debt funds. Okay, in it. Okay, just as we have different type of vehicles, similarly we have got different type of mutual funds. Okay, so remember one thing, that mutual fund, like if you buy an equity mutual fund, then that fund would have anything from 20, 30 to 50, 60 shares. Okay, but when you buy shares on your own, you will probably have 1 to 5, 20, whatever you want. But your fund manager will diversify into maybe 20, 30, 40, 50, 60 number of shares. So it's a wide portfolio which you get. Okay, what are the advantages of mutual funds? There is no entry load. Some of them will an exit load depending on the duration curve. There is no brokerage if you invest on your own. Significant tax advantages, safety, transparent. You can open an HEF account. You can open a minor account. You get automatic diversification, which reduces the risk. You can make it as complex as you want, as simple as you want. Best investment brings at least cost. Professional management is highly liberal. It's full liberty. You have flexible, scalable the way you want. You can put in crores and crores of rupees, no problem. You get options depending on your risk level, and it is totally SEBI regulated. You can invest minimum of 500 rupees, which is very easy to do. It is extremely liquid. You put a mandate today. Within 2 to 5 days, the money will come to your bank account automatically. You can do 24 hours a day. Very easy. Even a novice can invest. You can invest internationally. That's a big advantage through mutual funds without any worries. You can nominate. You can do loans. You can do SLP, SWP, STP. And wherever the money is invested, that fund has to disclose its total portfolio every fortnightly. So there is no secret involved. You can see what is being done. And it's very easy. You get a risk committee should tell you how much risk you've got, and your fund can play a major role in the company's decision making. Okay, mutual funds removes confusion. Okay, now one big difference between mutual funds and direct stock investing is that in mutual funds, your fund manager is just the job. Let's say the mutual fund has got 30 shares, 30 different companies, and he feels that one of those 30 companies is doing very well, it has reached its growth. He will sell it on our behalf and buy something else. So we don't have to worry about it. The fund manager, because I get very often people ask me, okay, my fund, which you told me is doing very well, now I'll big profits and all that. This is a big difference between mutual funds and direct stocks. In direct stocks, you buy an X company share, which you feel has reached its growth. You will have to sell it and take the money and buy some other share. Okay, because otherwise that company may now falter. If you feel that the profit may go down, but in mutual fund, This will be done automatically by your fund manager. So please don't book profits in mutual fund. Don't compare the two. They're totally different things. In mutual fund, your fund manager, if he feels that X share of that 30 share which he held has reached its growth, he will sell it and buy something else. Okay, so your fund will keep on growing. We need not treat mutual fund like share. This is a very common mistake people make. And they keep on calling me, "Apar, iska to growth ho gaya, it is making profit." So what do? You sell. So now which mutual fund you will buy now? You get confused because your fund was doing well, but you will buy somewhere else which will be inferior. So don't mistake. This is a very important concept. Therefore, I've spent some time on it. Okay. Second thing is mutual funds give you diversification. That's excellent. Okay. Now some facts about the Indian mutual fund industry. We've got about the total fund industry today is about 30 lakh crores, which is minuscule compared to the world. We've got about 42 asset management companies and approximately one third of the money, which is about 9 lakh crores or 10 lakh crores of it, comes from Mumbai. Okay. The big names in India are State Bank of India, which is about 5 lakh crores plus. Second is ICICI Prudential, then HDFC, Aditya Birla, Nippon, etc. And the middle group, some of the big ones or the good ones which I like are Mirae Asset, Canara Robeco, and Axis. These are the two good ones. Okay. This is the whatever. Okay. And how much of Indian mutual fund industry is kind of managed by women? It's about 3.5 lakh crores of this is managed by the women in India. Okay. Now,
sorry to interrupt. Can you go back two slides and once again tell what are the best mutual funds?
No. These are not the best mutual funds. These are the best mutual funds. These are the mutual fund companies.
Okay.
They are the best. I just mentioned the big ones. Right. Okay. The best ones will come later on. Sandeep, don't confuse. What I mentioned here are the big ones. It doesn't mean good.
Yeah, I got it.
Yeah. Okay. I just told the big ones, big names. Okay. In fact, I just tell you here, you should see the big ones, State Bank of India, ICICI, HDFC, the top four or five. SBI, ICICI, Aditya Birla, Nippon India, Kotak, IDFC. I have not a single paisa in any of these companies. Okay. So they are big, but they are not good. Okay. That is because of the marketing and the name, etc. I'll be in the later on, I'll be enumerating where my money, there's no secret, I don't keep secret. I will tell you where my money is invested. I'll tell you the names of the schemes where I have invested. Okay, so I have no problems in that. And they are in Axis, Mirae, in Canara Robeco, etc. I'll be telling you later on then. Okay, fine. Now, another question is, what is NAV, net asset value? This is the value of one unit. So when you buy a mutual fund, you'll be, suppose you put in 1 lakh rupees, you'll be allotted certain units. Okay, so your unit holding is in X, and that will keep, so that is the something like a book value of the fund. Okay, so suppose the net asset value is, let's say, 10 rupees. So when you buy for 100 rupees, you will get 10 units. So you got 10 today, and the NAV was 10. Let's say after 1 year, it becomes 20. So you will still have 10 units, but your NAV has become 20. Okay, so NAV means net asset value. It is a value of one unit of that fund. Okay, it is just to understand that you can go by the numbers of the rupees. Doesn't make much of a difference. Okay, but do not confuse this with a stock price. Okay, stock price is the actual value of that share. It will go up or down. And this is a very common myth which the agents use to fool you to buying a new fund. With reality, this is available at cheaper price. Okay, it is a myth and to fool you. Don't fall into the trap. Okay, now, what are the 7 websites which are useful? The first one I highlighted because I am a big fan of it. I've been using it for almost 15, 20 years now, and I access it every morning. I spend at least 10, 15, 20 minutes on it every morning. I read articles on it, and whatever knowledge I'm telling you in my talks in the last, and whatever I've learned in the last 10, 15, 20 years, whatever, is all from practically from this site. It's free. The amount of information given on this site is mind-boggling. It's totally free. No site in the world gives you so much exhaustive details. Okay, so I would request to go to it and play with the site with that mind-boggling information. There are a list of other sites which you can follow. Okay, and our 7 publications, the first two I read regularly. I would request all of you all to subscribe to this newspaper. It comes on every Monday. It is published by the Economic Times Group. It costs 8 rupees. Tell your newspaper man to give it every Monday morning. It is 8 rupees. It is on mutual funds. But more of it is on personal investment. Start subscribing, read it. It is very basic, user-friendly, and excellent. Okay, so do that. And I've listed some of the other magazines available. Websites available where you can transact. I use the first one, but there are so many of them. You can use whichever you feel like. Okay. Now, what do you look for in a fund before you buy? So look at the pedigree of the fund house, the tracking of the fund house, the past performance of the fund. What is the market scenario? Is it equities going to do well or debt funds? What is your objective? What is your risk profile and the risk available? Okay. Now, all funds are not similar. There are huge differences between them. So now I come to the basic crux of mutual funds. So what are different types of mutual funds? I classify them in about 9 different types. The first one is, where is this fund going to invest? So you have got equity funds, you've got debt funds, you've got combination things called as hybrid funds, you've got commodities in gold, you've got index funds and fund of funds. I'll talk briefly about them later on. Then how you can invest on your own, DIY, which is direct fund, which is what you should do. Or you go through an agent, sort of a regular plan. You could hold it in a single name, joint name, or either of survivor. Please go invest in either of survivor basis. You can text in an email or physical. You could have an open-ended fund or a closed-ended fund. Of these dependents are the equity funds, direct funds, and either of survivor basis. Then the expenses can be the form of entry load, which has been abolished in India. You've got exit load. Then you've got the brokerage, stamp duty, and the total expense ratio. Dividends can be growth or dividend. Now, dividend is a misnomer. Don't confuse this with a dividend what you get from the shares. Dividend here has been changed to called as IDC, which is income distribution come capital withdrawal, which means in if you get withdrawal from the money, dividend, it means your money come back to you. So you should not go for dividend plans. You could have an active or a passive fund, domestic, international, and growth of value, etc. And then the system in terms. I will talk briefly about some of them which are important to us. Okay. Now, equity, debt, hybrid, and commodity. What are equity funds? As I said, equity funds are the funds which will invest in equity. Equity funds are volatile, but they're also going to give you high returns. If you want long-term returns, if you're investing in long-term, you have to invest in equity. It's more than 5 years later, invest equity. If you don't, because equity is the only returns which will give you it will easily beat inflation. So if you want to end up with good returns and not to have poverty when you are retired, then you have to invest in equity. If your horizon is 7 years or more, invest in equity. Okay? Then in equity, we'll see later what is this. If you invest in debt funds, then they're very stable. They'll invest in bonds, deposits, money. So they're fixed income sort of things where you will get little maybe a 1 or 2% more than the bank FD rates. But then sometimes you will not beat inflation. So if you are investing, but then money is going to be a little more safe. So if you are investing in the short term, lesser than maybe 2-3 years, then debt funds may be better. It also depends on your risk-taking ability. And you can have a combination of the two, the various combinations, and you could get returns depending on the ratio you choose. Okay, so you get hybrid, you get aggressive, mixed, etc., etc. Suitable for 3 to 5 years, and you can invest in gold also through mutual funds. Okay, there are about 11 types of equity funds. Large cap, large and mid cap, multi cap, focus, etc., etc. Okay, the good ones are the multi cap or the focused funds, ELSS and international flexi cap, and for long term maybe mid and small cap. Okay, this is the various CBS defined what a large cap fund. If a company says that this is a large cap fund, then it is defined that they have to put X amount in the large cap, etc., etc. Okay, so there are different types how they've been categorized. Okay, ELSS means equity linked savings scheme. This is a type of equity fund where the money is locked in for 3 years. It is got a Section 80C benefit, and you can put up to 1.5 lakh among all the investment which you can do. This is the best investment from the type of from the point of view of returns. It's going to be a 3-year lock-in, and the returns are the best among all of them. Then we have the index fund. And the ETFs. Okay. Now I'll just tell you what this was somebody asking also.
Manoj, your voice is not audible.
Problem is with his internet, I think. He's disconnected.
Okay.
We'll wait for him to join back.
Yeah. Okay. And your voice was not clear. Either you can use, earlier also, your voice was not clear. So if you can come close to the speaker and then speak, or a earphone. Yeah. Okay. Manoj, unmute yourself.
Dr. Manoj, can you unmute yourself?
Yeah, it's okay now.
Yeah. Yes.
One second. Just 1 second. Is it okay now? Am I okay now?
Yes.
Okay. Am I visible and audio? Everything's okay now?
Yes. Go ahead.
There was some internet issue now. Okay. So. 1 second. My screen is not. Yeah. Okay. Fine. So as I said, the equity investments can be in two types. One is the active investment and the passive one. In active, the fund manager will keep on buying and selling the shares depending on his expertise and his perception of the share and the market. Now, if in a passive investments, your money will be invested in the index fund. I told you before that we got the Sensex and the Nifty. So if you want to buy the index fund, then your money, depending on these investment you do. So the fund manager will just copy the index. That is, since they're copying the index, there is no activity involved. Active management, there is a passive fund. So therefore you have the active investment and the passive investment. Okay. Now this can be in the form of either an ETF or an index fund. So index fund is if you buy through a mutual fund, that's an index fund. And ETF is called as the exchange traded fund. This is bought as a stock, okay, traded on the stock exchange, and this you buy through your demat account. Okay, so that they're almost similar, but the index fund is from a mutual fund, which will be through a mutual fund company, and the ETF stands for exchange traded fund, which is similar to the same thing, but it is traded like a stock every day. So it varies throughout the time, the cost varies throughout the day, and it is through a demat account. Okay, so that's the basic thing. Okay, fine. Now there are about 17 types of debt funds. The important ones are short duration, ultra short, liquid, overnight, etc., etc. And each one of them has been defined by SEBI. Now people always ask me to tell me, I've invested in this fund, that fund. So I'll just tell you briefly what is the difference between these funds. See, remember one thing, that the duration of a fund is and the returns are variable. Now, when we say a long duration fund or a short, what does it mean? In a long duration fund, the instruments which the fund invests are going to have an average maturity of more than 7 years. Okay, so in long duration fund, if you invest in long duration, your money will be in papers which will have investment duration of at least 7 years. Okay, short duration would be about 1 to 3 years. Ultra short would be about 6 to 9 months or 6 to 12 months. Okay, overnight for about a day. Okay, now remember one thing, that the returns generally have an inverse proportion. What I'm trying to say is that, let's say the invest now, if you've invested in a debt fund, let's say today invest is about 6%. Now in future, if the interest rates goes up, then the value of your debt fund will go down, because if the interest rates goes to, say, let's say 7%, then your investment is giving you 6%, which means the value will fall down. So if the interest rate is going to go higher up in the market later on, then the value of debt fund will go down. If you feel the interest rates will be going down, then the value of your fund will go up. Okay, so in a rising interest income, your value will go down. In a depressing interest regime, your value will go up. Okay, now, but because if you put in a long-term debt fund, then your money is locked down in long-term. Therefore, it will have a higher interest rate or volatility. Okay, so therefore, it is said that better to invest in ultra-short short-term fund. So therefore, they will be subject to less volatility. Okay, currently, the interest rate in India is about 5.5-6%. And it's unlikely to go down. It may go up a little. So if it goes up, then if you bought long-term funds now, then your value will go down. I hope I have understood. So it's an inverse relation. Okay. So that's what generally how the debt funds function. Okay. And hybrid funds, you've got something which will invest in a mixture of debt and equity funds, depending on the ratio. You have aggressive fund, balanced, conservative, equity saving, etc. Okay, they will invest partly in both. Okay, and return risk is obviously the debt funds are on the lower scale, balanced fund more than that, equity much more, and the most risky are the thematic or the sectoral funds in equity. Okay, SEBI has said that each fund is supposed to give you a riskometer, look at the lower half. So any fund you invest, well, if you will understand, we give you a graph and tell you how risky the fund is. So you can make a judgment and decide whether you're an investor or not. Okay. Now, this is very important. What is it? Comes in two types of okay. A direct plan would means that you're doing it on your own. Therefore, there is no broker. Okay, when there is no broker, you decide and the risk and everything is yours, but you save at least 1% a year, which is a huge amount of money, which over a period of 10-15 years can make a difference of 10-15%. Your agent will get approximately 1% every year, irrespective of his advice given to you, as long as your money stays in the fund, which is a huge thing. Okay, so please go for direct plans, put in a little effort, study on your own, but go for direct plans. Okay, and you see the difference? You can get 30% more return if you come to that 30% more return. It is huge, believe me. Okay, And now, how do you say the attainment of AMC, for example,
I think we have lost him again. Hello?
Yes, sir. There's a, I think, some internet issue.
His internet is not where, I think he's giving him trouble.
Yes. I think we'll have to wait until he joins, sir.
Okay. I'll stop my video. Got it. Okay.
Stop your video, yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Got it. Sorry. Okay. Okay. Is it better now?
Yeah. Go ahead.
Okay. Sorry. How many slides do I need to go back?
You can go back 2 slides.
This one. Okay, so I was talking about direct bands. So I would request put in a little effort and put in study a little and please do direct bands. You will save a huge amount of money in the long run. Okay, now how do you switch from a regular plan to a direct plan? Okay, so what you can do is that I'll just repeat this. So let's say you've got a Myra Asset X regular plan. Now you want to shift to a Myra Asset scheme only. Then you can do 2 things. If it is, suppose you want to invest, switch from the same scheme. So you can go to Myra Asset X direct plan or a Myra Asset Y direct plan. You can go to the Myra Asset site, log in and just give an option of switch and the money will be switched. Okay. So if it's the same AMC, it is very easy to do it. If it is you're shifting from, let's say from a Myra Asset regular plan to shift to, let's say a Canara Robeco direct plan, then you would have to give a mandate to the Myra Asset to redeem. Then the money will come into your bank account and then you'll have to buy it. Okay, I'll repeat. So with the same AMC, it can be done as an easy switch. If it is through a different AMC you're buying, then the money will have to be redemption to your bank account and then you have to buy on your own. But remember one thing, if it's the same AMC and you are switching it, it still means for taxation purposes, selling one and buying the other. Okay, only thing is, the money will be done directly in the fund house, so money will not go through your bank account. But for income tax purposes, for tax purposes, and you will have to show it in your bank account and your returns because the income tax authorities will automatically come to know about it. So you can't hide it. Only convenience-wise, it can be done as a switch. It is easy. If you don't want to switch, you can do the same way. You can tell them to redeem the money. Money comes into your bank account and then you can buy it fresh. Okay. So these are 2 methods you can do. Or if you can't do it online, you can download the form, fill it up and courier the form to the fund house. Okay. Now, how do you know whether your scheme is in a direct or a regular plan? Very easy. The 2 clues to it. Look at the statement. If you have highlighted them, 1, the name of the scheme would have a direct written in there. As I've highlighted in the lower red box, you will see the name direct, the term direct in your scheme name. And if you look at the right column, then there is a column of the distributor name, etc. It is going to be blank and ever that will be named. That means there is no agent. If the agent is there, then the agent name and his code number would be there, and the term direct would not be there in the name of the scheme. I know many people who the agents still tell them that no, there is no agent, there's no commission, and they fool them. Okay. And then we have the systematic schemes, which are your SIPs, STPs, and SWPs. Is very useful and helpful. SIP is most recommended as an investment. In SIP, your money goes every month as a fixed amount through your bank account to the scheme directly. it is automatic, and you invest, you know, little every month, and becomes a huge amount of money over a period of time. Since it's automatic, your heart is not involved, you don't have to worry about your market sentiments, and you get a lot of rupee cost and averaging. So SIP is very good. For example, if you invest, as I said before, I told you an example before, you invest 3,000 rupees a month for 30 years, okay, as a SIP, it becomes 1 crore of 30 years. If you invest for 30 years, at 3 crores. Okay, so SIP is a fantastic. And STP is something similar to SIP, but here the money goes from one fund to the other fund in the same fund house and not from your bank account. Okay, so it is something like an SIP. And STWP is when you want to withdraw money from your bank account, you can, if you don't want lump sum, you want steady income, the next amount every month, you can give a mandate for SWP. So on a particular date, the next amount which you given would come into your bank account. So this is SWP. So SIP is investment at a regular investment. STP is similar from your one fund to the other fund, the same fund house. And SWP is withdrawal from the fund house. How to invest? You should decide whether you think, what's your aim. So this tax saving, long term, short term, retirement plan, and what is your goal? Okay. Then you need to be KYC compliant. You should be, your PAN number should be available. Your bank account should be online with your name in the bank account, and decide how you want to invest. Okay. Then how much you want to invest? What are the returns you are expecting? What is your risk and volatility risk? And is it short term or long term? So these things should be clear in your mind. Okay. And then you can invest, as I said before, online through AMC, you can do it, from portals, you can do it, etc. Or you can download the form and you can submit. Okay, there are various ways you can do it. Okay. Now we have got two registrars, CAMS and CARVI. This is the name. CARVI, CAMS and K FinTech. One is another one is for Franklin Templeton. CAMS is for about 16 funds. There's 26 funds are with CARVI. You can invest in any of these online also. How do you get a mutual fund statement? This is like a bank account. And if you look at the fund, there are many things in, like, it's got your personal details, your folio number, your account number, your bank details, your KYC, your name of the scheme, how much you've invested, the current value, date. Okay. What are the returns you get? You get many returns. What is important is the last one, compound annual growth rate. Okay. That's the only thing important. The rest you can ignore, and you can get this from various sites. Okay. Now people ask me, I want to know how much is your fund giving me? What is my SIP giving me? What do I do? I don't bother about them. You really not bother, because you invested for long term, you invested in good schemes, the fund will do well automatically. Okay. I really don't bother about the specific fund returns or what is my SIP or STP do. I keep a general view of the trend. I just look at my fund performance on a general basis. And if the fund is still rated well, I just don't bother about it. Unlike shares, if you're investing in shares, then you would need to know what is happening to shares. But in mutual funds, really don't bother about the details of these things. Oh, my fund is giving me 9%, somebody is giving me 11.2%. It's not important. Okay. Mutual fund investment should be like watching grass grow or paint dry. What does it mean? Do nothing about it. Don't bother about it. Don't get stressed about it. If you still want details, especially for your income tax purposes, very easy. You know, click on a button. For mutual funds, you can get them. Go to your CAMS or Pay FinTech. Put in your PAN number, and then give you various options. You can get your portfolio, your current holding, your NAVs, your profit, long-term profit, capital gains, loss of statements, grant funding statement, all these are easily available. You can go to these sites, put in your PAN number, and you can get them in your email within a few hours. Okay, very easy. Okay, I use this for these things. Okay, fund ratios, there are about 16 of them, all technical. What do I do? Nothing about it. Ignore them. I don't look at them. Don't bother about them. Just go to any mutual fund site and look at the ratings of it. Depending on your risk ability, go for ratings and buy the schemes you want. So don't bother about these ratios. Help with them, not interested, not important. Okay. Okay. Now, when you want to withdraw the money, very easy. Where do you normally withdraw? When all fund performances skip. If you want the money for X purposes, you need the money, take it out. Or your fund purpose has gone down, you need the money, withdraw. Go to online, put your mandate, you want an X amount, the money will come into your scheme, in your bank account. Okay. Okay, now where do you invest? Confused? How many funds should I have? Okay, you should normally buy, if you maybe 5 or 6 or maximum 7 funds enough. If you're buying index funds, then 1 or 2 funds is enough. Okay, need not buy more than 5 to 6 or 7 funds, because more than those funds, your returns are not going to increase, but your confusion and your difficulty in managing would increase. Okay. How you buy? If you're buying equity funds, then for long term, you should buy maybe flexi-cap funds or aggressive equity funds or ELSS funds, mid-cap fund for more than 7 years, small cap, etc. And short, if you're buying for short term use, then maybe at less than 3 years you can buy debt funds. Okay. This is a general rule we have. If you're buying for less than 3 years, you buy short term funds. If you're buying medium term, then maybe hybrid funds. And if you're buying long term, then equity funds. What you should do is buy good fund depending on your need and just follow them. Don't do much about it. Okay. I'm not going to enumerate the funds. These are lists of funds which are available on any site, all publications, mutual funds, newspapers, etc. have it. No point enumerating the names. So this I will skip away. These are different. I just named different funds which are available. Okay, and as you can see on this slide, the performance of some funds keeps on changing, depend from year to year. Okay, and I just follow the value star rating for the performance. Okay, now where is my money invested? This is what I've got. Okay, so my investments are in these schemes, all are direct growth scheme on either survivor basis. And I've got, three flexi-cap funds, 3 because the mandate changed about 2 years back. I've got 1 large and mid-cap fund, 1 mid-cap, 1 small cap, and 1 tax saver fund, and 1 debt fund for the STP. And for international funds, mutual funds can be used to invest internationally also easily. And so you can buy Microsoft, Amazon, Alphabet, Netflix, etc. Taxation. We've got 2 types of taxations, long term and short term. Am I audible?
Yeah, you're audible.
Am I audible? I'm not sure.
Yes, Manoj, you are audible.
Is things okay, Sandeep?
Oh, the screen is not visible.
Okay. Now, taxation, we've got long-term and short-term taxation. For equity funds, the break-off is 1 year. Fair enough. I can continue? Oh my God.
Can you make
what are you happen? Sharing? I don't know.
Are you sharing?
I've got the full net here. I don't know what is happening.
Can you unshare your screen and start again? Unshare
is your screen. Is the screen visible now?
Something is wrong with your sharing. So I would say that unshare your screen and start again.
I'll do that. 1 minute. Yeah. I'm trying to figure out how to do it. Okay, stop share. Okay, share screen. Is it okay now?
We can't see.
Is it okay now?
We can't see your screen.
Is it okay now?
We can't see your screen.
But it's showing share here. I don't know. I'm getting a screen. I'm sharing screen. That's what, but here it's telling me.
Now we can see, sir. We can see now.
So I'll, stop share. Go share screen.
We could see it was taking some time.
I don't know what is happening.
Just wait for some
time. Fine. Okay. It's okay.
Yeah, it will start.
It's okay now.
When it starts. Right now, it is just
okay.
Your screen is loading.
So till the time you share your screen,
Manoj, we can take questions in the meantime.
Yeah. Question from Dr. Sandeep Sonone.
Yeah.
Is a ECAN number essential for switching from regular to direct plan?
No, ECAN number is if you're investing there is.
Manoj,
okay, so they give you ECAN number. So if you have an ECAN number, you can go through mutual utilities. Sorry?
Yeah. Continue.
Okay. So ECAN number is something which is given by an entity called as mutual fund utilities. So if you have an account with them, then you will be able to go through them. But if you don't have an ECAN number, it is fair enough. You can do it through your mutual fund site directly, through CAMS, KFintech, or through your mutual fund site directly. You need not have an ECAN number. It's not necessary.
So are you able to log in again?
I am logged in.
Can you completely unshare your screen? Start your video.
1 minute. Is it coming now?
Yeah, it has come now. You have to just play or enlarge it.
Sir, I would suggest if, yeah, now it's okay. Sorry.
Okay. So taxation of mutual funds. We are different from equity and debt. Okay, so your long-term, short-term for equity, the cutoff is 1 year. So your flat 50%, more than 1 year. For gains, more than 1 lakh is 10%. Okay, for debt, it is 3 years. So less than 3 years added to your income. More than 3 years is 20% with indexation. International funds and fund of funds are treated as debt funds. Short-term capital loss can be set up against short-term capital gains and long-term capital gains. So this you can use for tax benefit. I'll skip off. Okay. Now last few slides. I follow this, as I said before, it is mind-boggling. You can go to the homepage. There are various articles. Read them. If you click on funds, then you can get a slide like this. And you get all the details. You can click on each one of them. Then you can each category. Then you can go to each category. You can click and you can get every individual fund. You can get every details of every individual fund free from mind-boggling thing. Now I invest through an entity called as mutual fund utilities. Okay, it is a common platform formed by all the mutual fund companies. It's free. So all of them are there. If you open an account on it, you get an ECAN number and you can transact, you can do all transactions through this. So this single platform, very convenient. So you can open an account through mfuindia.com, it's online. Okay. And then you can transact through mfuindia.com. So this is what I follow and you can do all these things. Okay. Some of the do's and don'ts. Don't rule, let your heart rule your head. No emotions, I don't have, I buy and sell if I need to. Don't stop SIPs, don't panic. Don't hold more than 7 mutual funds. Don't time the market, don't procrastinate. Start buying today. People think that it's only for stock market, you can buy debt funds also. Don't buy any NFOs, okay? And don't play it like the share market, okay? They are more safer than the stock investments. You can do online and you can do tax saving, etc. through this. Depending on, you can have debts, mutual equity, golds, property, etc. All this can be done. And okay, one difference between nominee and head In mutual funds, the nominee is a caretaker. Nominee is the will not get the will is a caretaker. The holdings do not go to him after you. It is the is the legal heir or depending succession succession the mutual funds will go to. Okay, I think that's it. Thank you. I've somehow, sorry, we had some internet issues in between. So that's what it is. Maybe we can.
Can you?
I'm open to question answers now.
Yeah, Manoj, can you clarify about the nominee? Like,
Sandeep,
can you clarify about the nominee if you have not nominated anybody?
Okay. See. Yeah.
I think his audio is also gone.
I think his internet is unstable.
Yeah.
He's locked out again.
I'll give a call to him.
Yeah, nominee is, see, we normally think that if we have a nomination done, then after us, the holdings will go to the nominee. No, nominee is just a caretaker in the mutual fund. After you, it is the job of the nominee to transfer it to the legal heir. So in mutual funds, the amount after you will not go to the nominee. It is your will. If you've not made a will, it will go depending on your religion and your succession, it will go. So if you're a Hindu, it will go to the class one heir or the class two heir, etc. So nominee is not, will not get it. Remember, a lot of people think that my nomination kiya hai, usko milega, no. For example, if you're a Hindu, that if you've not done a nomination, sorry, if you don't have a will, then the money will be divided among your wife, your mother, and your children. Okay, something like that. So you have to be very careful. Okay, if you have a joint holding, either survive, that's the best thing to do. So after you, your spouse will get it. That's the best, as we say, you should do it in that basis. But so you should make a will. If you don't want your holdings, your investments or thing to go to people who are your class one heir, but you don't want it to go to them, make a will. Okay. So your nominee is just a holder, just a caretaker. He will not be the owner of your mutual funds. Remember this. Am I clear?
Yes. Very good.
Yeah.
Now, one more question. How do you decide at what time of the investment you should redeem or you continue? Whether it is 2 years, 3 years, 5 years, how do you decide that? You said it's my requirement as well. Like,
yes.
See, if I don't have requirement, how do you decide whether I should redeem and switch to another one?
See, in mutual funds, you will withdraw the money based on 2-3 conditions. One, if you want the money, then you got no option but to withdraw the money. If you feel the performance of your scheme has gone down compared to similar schemes. Otherwise, don't withdraw the money if you don't want the money. Because as I said before, if your fund is doing well, it will continue to do well. You need not withdraw the money, unlike shares. I'll give you my example. Okay, the last time I withdraw money was almost 16, 17, 18 years back. After that, I have not withdrawn the money. What do you mean the money? Whatever I'm earning, little bit, I keep on investing. After my expenses are done, the rest of money is being invested. So I'm earning. So that is taking expenses. I have not withdrawn the money. So withdraw so in shares, you need to withdraw the money. You have to withdraw because you feel that company money has grown to work. So you withdraw and buy something else. In mutual fund, your fund manager will do it for you. So your fund money value will keep on growing. So you don't have to withdraw the money at all unless you need the money. Please don't come. I get so many phone calls from people. Are you fund acha chal raha hai? Abhi main paisa nikal leta hun because abhi to bahut badh gaya, abhi gir jayega. No. Okay. So don't. Yeah.
Regarding the entry, I think there is one question also related to that from Kalpin. So when the market crashes, is it a right time to invest in a mutual fund?
See, yeah. So that is a bonus. That is volatility. So if the market crashes, it is a boon to you. You should buy. I'll give you my example. Okay, last year in Corona, March 23, the market crashed from about it was about 45,000 crashed to about 26,000. Okay, so 40% crash. Okay? So,
Shitish, his audio is not.
His internet is giving him trouble.
No. So you can. Kalpen, is your question answered? Dr. Kalpen?
No, he can't unmute himself. You'll have to, we'll have to unmute him.
So there is one more question from Ashit.
Should I allow participants to unmute themselves?
Yes.
So now participants can unmute themselves to speak, but I would rather, you know, have them raise their hand so that you can identify us if you want someone to identify.
Okay, so I'm sorry for the internet. My Wi-Fi is on, my hotspot is on, and I don't know what is happening. I'm sorry. Now repeat this answer. So in mutual funds, you need not do it. Okay, so what I did last year was I had some average performing fund which I could not sell because of tax exemption purpose. When market crashed, so it all losses. So I sold and I redeemed I switched a lot of things. So I sold at a loss. Okay. I bought better funds, better rated fund, which I wanted to do, and I sold at loss. So I've encountered long-term capital losses, which I can carry forward for 8 years. So in the next 8 years, whichever I say, even if it is a profit, I will not be able to pay tax because I've got accumulated long-term capital losses. So I switched to better funds, which I couldn't do before. I bought long-term losses. I was not talking about the market. Okay. The annual market will go up. Okay. Second thing is I had some savings in the bank and I had some debt funds. So I bought equity in that. So those have more than doubled now. Plus I got all these advantages. Okay. I was very happy when the market crashed. People may think I'm a fool or I'm a sadist, but I did that. Okay. And my returns have become phenomenal now because of the crash in the market. This was a once in a lifetime opportunity. It may never come back again. Okay, and at that time I was advising people to do it, but people say, no, your market is crashed, not to buy. I remember when the market came to 44,000, 45,000, some of people who are, you know, taking my advice, I told them buy. No, it is 44,000, 45,000, abhi to girega market, girega, COVID is still there. I kept on buying. Okay, it's come to 44,000, 50,000, 51,000 now, and they are still waiting. So never time the market, even now buy. Play with the Indian. India is going to grow, it's going to keep on growing. I am buying whenever I have some, even 10,000 rupees in my bank account, I buy. So I don't look at the index, I don't look at the market, I just keep on buying. I bought when the index was 44,000, 46,000, I have kept on buying, knowing well that the market may crash. Don't bother about it, just keep on buying, because you know if it is 50 today, it may crash to 40 tomorrow, but you are sure after 1 year, 2 years, it will become 50, 60, 70,000. You try to time the market, you wait for market to come down, you may wait for all your life, it may never happen. So don't do it.
Shitish, any questions? I think there was one from Sandeep Sonone. Are 10% capital gains calculated for each fund separately, or it is a cumulative capital gains?
It is a cumulative in 1 year. April 1 to March 31st is your financial year. So within that year, everything will be added. So whatever long-term capital gains or losses you got, take the net of it. And that is what is, if you got capital gains, then up to 1 lakh of that is non-taxable. Suppose you got 90,000 long-term capital gains, then no tax. If it is 1,10,000, so 1 lakh is exempted. So 10,000 pay, you pay 10% of that. So you pay 1,000 rupees tax you will pay. Have you understood? Okay. So it is cumulative of all that. So you add up your long-term capital losses, long-term capital gains, add them up. And if it is for equity, it is 1 lakh above. So up to 1 lakh, no tax. I hope you understood. For debt funds, cutoff is 3 years. So below 3 years, whatever gains you get is added to your income of that year. So most of us are in 30% tax bracket, you pay 30% tax on it. If it is more than 3 years, it's 20% within the SAJ. So if you're investing in debt funds, as far as possible, don't withdraw below 3 years. After 3 years, you will get good returns, because then the difference between debt funds and FD is phenomenal, because you get less tax and indexation benefit.
Another question is PMS preferred?
Is PMS? Yeah. Okay, PMS means Portfolio Management Services. Okay, I will now a few things about it. As I said before, don't invest in things you do not understand. PMS, I don't understand. What is PMS? You have some entity, and today the law is that you can't, it is minimum is 50 lakh rupees. So they will take a minimum 50 lakhs from you, and they will buy and sell shares on your behalf in your demat account through your bank account. Okay. And PMS, the problem with PMS is one, it is very expensive. They have a fixed charge, plus they will take a fixed percentage of the profits, which could be high. The losses are yours. And every time they buy and sell a share, it is through your account. So you pay tax on it. Remember one thing. So your taxation, and you will keep on buying it, doing it throughout the year. So you'll end up with long-term capital taxes. Suppose they buy a share one today, after 1 month, they sell it. So you pay short-term capital, 15% of the growth of the tax. Plus they will take charges. And it's very non-transparent. They will get the money, you may or may not. In the long run, except a handful of PMS, most of them are not doing well. Okay. My advice is don't go for PMS. You will, in the long run, mutual funds will give you better returns and you will have sense of control over it. Don't go for PMS. My advice.
If you are trading daily, or if you trade for a, like in a high volume, is the taxation different for an individual and a trader? When do you call individual a trader?
Now, this is a subjective thing. The tax man will decide. If you are a trader, then the income is added, then it is added to your income. If you are an investor, then you have short-term capital gains of 10%, or 15%. So what they decide, they will see your history and whether you bought today, you sold it the same day, in 2, 3, 5 days. So depending on that, it decides is a trader or an investor. Okay. So it depends on your history, how fast you are trading, selling, etc., etc. So that turnover is how much. So that's a taxman decides. But trader, the income is added, that profit is added to your income. Remember this. So 30% tax.
Next question is from Amit. Sandeep, you have been unmuted. You can ask directly. The question from Dr. Amit Pispati. What are the balanced hybrid funds? Are they useful in current market where one doesn't know when there could be a sudden fall?
That's what I've already answered that. That's the wrong question to ask. You should be investing depending on your psychology, not on the basis of the market. Like, for example, I'll give you my example. I am a risk taker. I have practically never invested in debt fund. I've always invested in equity the last 20, 25, 30 years. Okay. So if you are a risk taker, your investment is for more than 7-10 years, then go for the equity. Don't look at the market, believe me. But if you are a person who is absolutely want to play safe, go for debt fund. If you are a person who is little risk taker, go for hybrid funds. Don't assume that you are waiting for the market to crash or go down. You may wait for a whole life, it may never happen. Okay, but so hybrid funds are for people who are first time investor, who are a little scared, who are investing for not for long duration, they want to not be very aggressive, then you go for hybrid funds. And hybrid funds, we've got various types. They are very aggressive, which will be about 65% plus in equity, 30-35% in debt. Then you've got moderately aggressive, maybe about 40% in equity. Then you've got very conservative, 10-15%. Then depending on your risk ability, you can go for it. Okay. But please, again, don't time the market. As I told you before, I'm buying my equity mutual funds. I bought when the index was 48, 50, 51%. They've all gone up. So don't time the market.
Prashant, you are unmuted. You can ask your question.
The purpose of mutual fund is discipline. we have to keep investing when the market is at all-time high. We do SIP, and when there is a steep fall, we invest in bulk. The participants who are investing in mutual funds, they are big bulls. They are always long. It is not about timing the market. It is about investing regularly. If you want to do timing, it is better to invest in shares and time the market as per share cycle. Mutual funds are definitely not a product which should be timed.
Absolutely correct. Okay. See, mutual fund is because of your fund manager will do the timing for you and keep on buying the sell for with no taxation to us and no headache and no worries. Okay. That, as I said before, if you want to do shares, then you can buy sell whatever you want. Mutual fund, the fund manager is a professional. He's doing it on our behalf. So don't worry about it. Okay. Don't time the market.
Yeah. Okay. Sangeet sir, I had a question. May I ask? Yeah. Sandeep here.
Yes, go ahead. Sandeep,
yeah. Just one. If I'm looking at a long-term investment in an equity fund and I reach my goal, when I shift to a depth fund, do I have to worry about the exit load if it's the same AMC or do I have to take it as a separate investment?
See, exit load is applicable to any scheme which you withdraw irrespective of the AMC. Okay. Now, exit loads depend on the scheme. Exit load is basically a thing which the AMC applies to as fund because they don't want you to withdraw the money before a certain duration. So all schemes don't have exit load. Generally, equity funds will have an exit load of 1% if you withdraw within a year. After a year, they don't have. This is a general rule. Some may have for 2 years, some may have whatever. And debt funds, depending on the fund, could have no exit load. Some could have for 1 week or 1 day or 1 month or whatever. Okay. So exit load is applicable depending on the scheme and depending on the point of time when you've invested. Even the exit loads keep on changing depending on the scheme. So at the point of your investment, the exit load will be the rule will follow when you've invested. Okay. Now, if you put for 7 years, there is no scheme which has got exit load applicable after 7 years. So your exit load, there will be no exit load if you withdraw after 7 years. Hope I'm clear.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
The next question is from Kalpin. Do you want to ask yourself? You have been unmuted.
Kalpin. Yeah. I would like to ask whether do you recommend to shift all presently held regular plans to direct plans of the same AMC?
Now when you want to shift from regular plan, it means you are selling the regular plan and buying direct plan. Okay. So the number one thing is selling that and buying a direct plan. So now you again go to the same basic rule. Now, so you decide which schemes you want. Just because you've got an investment in an X regular plan, you should go to an X direct plan. No. If you feel that X scheme is good for you or you is doing well, then you can switch from the regular to direct plan. Otherwise, it doesn't mean don't involve your heart. So now you make a fresh list of the investments you want to do, those 3, 4, 5 schemes you want, and invest in those. They could be from the same fund house, it could be a different fund house, it could be the same scheme regular direct plan. No, it is a total fresh investment. I hope I'm clear.
Okay.
Understood, Mr. Dr. Kalpin, hope you understood.
Yes, I got it.
Yeah. Okay.
Manoj?
Yeah.
There are two ways in which we can invest in mutual fund. One is a SIP and other is a lump sum.
Yeah.
Okay. Now, in a SIP, how long should we go on investing in a particular?
See, now it depends on you. You can make an SIP for, I think most of them have a minimum 6 month thing. But you can do it 1 year, 2 years, 5 years, 10 years, 100 years, your wish. Okay. See, depending on you. Simple thing is, like when I start an SIP, I normally keep it, it's my wish. I keep it for 3 years. Okay. After 3 years, I restart the SIP. You can start an SIP, let's say for 10,000 on 7th of a month. Then after, so you feel that you want more, you can start another SIP in the same fund of 15th of the month for 2 years or 5 years. Both SIPs will continue. Okay. The thing is that, and you can stop them whenever you feel like. It's up to you. There is nothing like that. You can go 6 months. And second thing is, let's say after 2 years, you feel that fund is not doing well. You give a mandate, stop SIP, it will stop. And let's say for some reason, you don't have money in the bank account. Okay. So the asset, the money will not go. There is no penalty, no risk. The fund house will send it for 3 months. Okay. So generally, if your money doesn't go for 3 months, then this SIP mandate is automatically stopped. No penalty, no risk, nothing to be ashamed of. Okay. Now you can start an SIP. Some schemes have you can have an SIP on a daily basis, weekly basis, fortnightly, monthly, quarterly. Okay. But it's been found by statistics that monthly SIP is the most convenient and most return wise is best. So usually we do SIPs monthly.
Now, how do you calculate the returns? It is much easier to calculate on a lump sum. Like we have invested, say, 5 lakhs in 2018. In 21, we know what is the...
Okay. Now, for an SIP return...
How can do it in SIP?
Okay. Now, in SIP, if you want to know the cumulative of SIP, it is called as XIRR. It's called as Extended Internal Rate of Return. Okay. So this is an XIRR ratio. You can go to the, depending on your AMC, RDA, it could be CAMS or K FinTech. So if you go to them, okay, log into your account and it's got a section on your returns. Okay, so click on it, it will give you the XIRR returns. So in XIRR, so every SIP installment, the return is given and calculated and given you totally once. But I'll tell you one thing. Believe me, last so many years and decades, I have never looked at it. You don't need to look at it. See, let's say I've got an investment in X scheme, which is going for last so many years. I don't bother. I just look at the general trend of that scheme, which is easily available in all publications online. That scheme is, you know, like for example, I've got it here. Now, this is the last week's ET Wealth paper. I'll just show you on this. It's 8 rupees. I told you every Monday I buy it. Now in this, I'll just show it to you. Okay. Now this lists the top performing schemes. Okay, of all the various types, equity and debt schemes. Okay. Now in this, there is a column of returns of all those top schemes of every category of 3 monthly, 6 monthly, 1 year, 3 years, and 5 years. Okay. So let's say I have an X scheme. I look at it. 1 month, 6 months, I know my SIP is also given that much. Okay, so I don't bother. And if I also have a copy of the Mutual Fund Insight, okay, now in the end, they've got about 15 pages of every scheme, all those thousand schemes which are there, all details of it are there. Okay, equity, hybrid, debt, all thousand schemes are there. Okay, with regular and direct plan and all the returns and everything is there. So I can look at it, okay? And then later on, they also have a SIP return. Okay, and I'll just show it to you here, 1 second. SIP returns of those schemes, top schemes, okay? Over a period of 3 years, 5 years mentioned here.
So okay. How often we should see it or we should see the paper? As you said, it is all a long term. We don't have to see the ratio. We don't have to see all the details.
It is an individual thing. There are people who would want to see it every day. Like I tell you, since I get the paper, I see it every week. And I go to Value Research online every morning. But then I go every morning to read the articles. The returns wise, I don't bother. You know, I just see the paper, glance through it, and that's it. I don't break my head over it because Value Research also gives a star rating. So as long as my fund has got a 4 or 5 star, I know it is doing very well. I don't bother. If it goes to 3 or something, see, when you put in mutual funds, don't have to put stress on your mind. Okay. Your fund manager is you've given the stress to him. See, if he doesn't perform well, the fund rating goes down. You know, people will withdraw the money. He will lose his name will go down. His fund company will get the money and that fund house will not do well. Like for example, I told you, the top 4 fund houses in India, money-wise, are SBI, HDFC, ICICI, and Aditya Birla. And I've got not a single paisa in all of them. Okay, because their schemes are not doing well. So you will ask me, if they're not doing well, how do you got so much money? It is the debt funds, or they've got money, and the branches, and the agents, and the marketing help. Okay. So,
Kshitij, any questions? Any more questions? So I'll ask you the last question and you can sum up. See, my colleague has, say, 10 lakhs in a fixed deposit. He has invested in property. He doesn't want to buy gold. He doesn't want to invest in equity. Correct. Now, what he should do ideally with this 10 lakhs?
See, again, we've come to the basic question.
He doesn't have a requirement at least for 2-3 years.
See, if it is 2-3 years, I would tell him to shift this FD amount, full amount, into a debt fund. Maybe a short-term debt fund. Choose maybe 2 or 3 debt funds, good 3 debt funds, and put maybe 3.5 lakhs in each of them. Okay? Because if it's 3 years, because over 3 years, he will get at least 1 to 2%, if not more, than the FD. If he keeps for 3 years, one day, he will get at least 10% more, than the FD return. Okay? Choose 2-3 so that it's divided on the fund houses. Okay? That's what I would tell him to do. Go to debt funds. Nothing else. No equity. And if he can be, if he wants a little aggressive, then maybe he can put maybe about 3 lakhs of those in an hybrid fund and maybe 6-7 lakhs in debt funds, because his horizon is only about 3 years. So I would not like him to take too much of risk or volatility. That kind of thing. That's what I would suggest. But mutual funds.
Right. Any questions from Shubhranshu? Swapnil?
No, that's fine. Thank you.
So, Manoj.
Yeah.
Thank you very much.
Welcome. I hope people have benefited. Yeah. I don't know how many were there.
Yes.
But let's hope you all have enjoyed this session. I've tried to give an overview of things.
Right.
Okay. Maybe if we have another session, then I can talk on insurance and retirement, how to plan for retirement, and how do you calculate how much you need to invest so that how much you would get, how to, all those things, you know, other things can come up there, and whether should you buy gold, should you buy property, etc. You know, those things we can do if there is another session later on.
It was an excellent session. Like our questions are very basic, and exactly we wanted.
It's not, you know, this is what people, in fact, certain, in that talk, lot of points I've covered is because what I'm getting feedback from the other people, questions.
Why I'm saying this is we have attended other seminar webinars where yes. they have gone in that depth where we could not understand or we cannot reach that level.
But that is nonsense. That is not, see, the talk should be tailor-made for the audience. See, I could have, in fact, I could have gone in too much of details of these things. My overall presentation has got about 1500 slides, okay, which is too much in depth. So when you approached me, I told you, if you remember 2 days back, I told you that I'm going to edit my slides depending on the audience. So I have to be basic so that you understand that is what you all require. Now, if I'm going to give a talk to maybe finance people or something, then we would have gone into a little more in detail, which is not required. You and me don't require that details. It's not required. What I told you is what is more than enough for people like us.
Right. So we should conclude now because we have crossed almost 15 minutes. Our time, closing time was 9:30. On behalf of Bombay Orthopedic Society, I am thankful you could give so much time to us and enlighten all our audience. Kshitij and Agnivesh were the webmasters. I thank them. Secretary of Bombay Orthopedic Society, Dr. Swapnil is here. He will, Swapnil, are you there?
Hello.
Yeah.
Hello.
Yes. Yes, Manoj, you can talk.
Yeah, I was just going to thank Sangeet and all your colleagues in the Bombay Orthopedic Society. I had, you know, when I got your message, it was BOS. I would have suggested maybe it could be BOSS. Wasn't it the boss? Maybe when the society name was formed, they could have made it Bombay Orthopedic Surgeons Society, something like that. You know, boss would have been, you know, more appropriate. Anyway, thanks to you all. I hope you have benefited. I have been doing this for the last 2-3 years. My aim is that people benefit. Our faculty or doctors should benefit. I always say that we are the most intelligent people of the society, but we are so much away from finance, these basic things, just simple things. We spend our whole day running here and there, working and earning, and we are taking for a ride by the fools, the brokers and all. we spend little time or not even much, and we can do it on our own. It's more fun, more thrilling to do on your own. You know, you spend 10 minutes of it every day, you would earn so much, much more better. You could have peace of mind and you could retire early.
Right. So thank you very much, Manoj.
Welcome.
We will conclude here and stop recording.
Yeah.
Kshitij? Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
Yes. Thank you, Manoj. Thank you very much once again. See you soon.
Yeah. Okay. Bye.
Yeah. Thank you. Go ahead.